It's 7:01. I want to convene the meeting of the West Newbury Board of Selectmen, and just want to open by mentioning, complimenting the police department for a July 4th incident where there was a car stolen in West Newbury, and it was recovered in, I believe, about 2 hours through work of two officers. So, very nice job. Did you want to say something, Art?
Sure. Do you mind if I come up?
Yeah.
This was, as you stated, it was on July 4th. It was about, it came to light about 8:30 in the morning. There was actually there was two burglaries in town, mm-hmm. one on Garden Street, which, as you alluded to, there was a vehicle that was inside the garage. Subsequently, a couple hours later, the person that stole the vehicle was apprehended by Officer Burwell and obviously one of our new trainees, Michael Silvestro. Actually, Officer Silvestro was the one that actually spotted the vehicle over in Newburyport when they were checking with the pharmacy where some items were purchased via a stolen credit card. And then during subsequent investigations, come to find out there was another burglary that happened on Cherry Hill as well. We believe it's the same person because some of the property that we recovered belonged to a resident on Cherry Hill. So just obviously do the hard work of a number of officers besides the two that I named, as well as Officer Johnson and Officer Forney, who did some work on the investigation as well. So. It's just good to obviously catch one of the bad guys for once. And it was all connected, obviously, to heroin.
It's one person that did the whole thing?
As far as we know right now, it's just one person. Yeah. There could be other homes that we're not aware of right now. He doesn't really have a permanent address that we've been able to ascertain at this point. But
very nice work.
Yeah, it was good work by especially a newcomer. Mm-hmm.
Well, team effort.
Yeah, so it was a team effort by a number of different officers, but it was a good job done by all. So I appreciate
good.
The kudos.
And yeah.
I just wanted to, why I got the board's ear. August 2nd, we're going to have again our national night out, and again, it's going to be held at Pawtucket. It's going to be pretty much the same that we've done in past years, except for we've invited Merrimack Police and Groveland Police to join us to kind of do a tri-town. So I'm trying to kind of work all that stuff together with them. The other chiefs are more than happy to join us since I guess we're doing most of the work. Both chiefs are very happy that we decided to invite them.
Be a much bigger event, have broader participation.
Well, that's what we hope. Obviously, yeah. Pawtucket is a tri-town school. So, my goal was always to try to involve the other departments where I hope if they have something, they'll obviously invite us. And we're going to have the K-9 from Essex Sheriff's Department. And I have a call to the Colonel State Police, so I'm hoping to get the helicopter to at least land for a little while. The problem is August 2nd is the date for everybody. So
helicopter's in demand.
Is that the date of the national?
Oh, everybody does it the same day.
Everybody that does it, that's the night they're going to do it. Pending a rainstorm, then they'll have to pick it.
And that's a Friday night.
August 2nd? No.
No.
I think it's Tuesday. Tuesday or Wednesday, it's during midweek.
Oh, what the heck am I talking about? I'm looking, okay.
What time does it start?
I can see it, it's got to be a Tuesday.
It's a Tuesday.
5 o'clock, 5 to 8.
I went one
5
over.
5 o'clock?
Yeah, 5 p.m. to 8 p.m. Obviously, fire department will be there, highway here will have some of their stuff. So it's not just police, we've tried to get a lot of people involved. There's going to be a lot of similar things as last time, but we're going to try to add a couple, obviously adding the new police departments, try to get them involved. And
any dunk tank this year?
Are you volunteering to be the dunkie?
I think he'll go get a tank.
No, I don't. You have one or no?
No,
you didn't have one last year.
Well, if you and Mike B are volunteering to be the dunkies, I'd be happy.
I have been 2 years. I was 2 years, but no.
I think he looked into it.
Warren did it. Warren did it.
I mean, who would not want to dunk the finance director?
That's right. I think you spent your money, and all kidding aside, I think they spent that money on something else that kids seem to have liked better, I think. Yeah.
Some of the inflatables maybe or something.
Yeah,
it was a bouncy house last year.
I think they diverted the money to something else.
So anyways, that's where we're going with that. I don't know if you've seen it on Facebook. We're doing a helmet safety thing with obviously skateboards and bicycles, so that's been a pretty good hit with the kids around town. We're giving out tickets for obviously ice cream cones or some version of ice cream, so that seems to be working quite well. And we're still in the process of interviewing dispatch and reserve police officers. That we obviously we get two that are working right now, but we still have a process that's going to be long going. So mm-hmm. something that won't be fixed overnight. It's going to take some time to do. And Sergeant Senior is working with me developing a new field training manual. The one that we've had before is a little outdated, so we're trying to get something new 21st century.
Oh, good.
So that's kind of it in a short note.
Okay.
So, but no,
thank
I appreciate
you.
The board allowing me to speak first thing, and thank you for
yep.
the kudos on behalf of the board.
You're well deserved.
What time did you say that was?
5 o'clock.
5 to 8. Yep.
I was just checking. I know I have something. Yeah. I'll be there.
Do you want me to make your reservations for the dunk tank?
No. I don't. No, I'm not. No.
Oh, there is one more thing. Glenn, I know I had emailed you a week ago about movie night. I know last few years the cable TV had co-sponsored with the police department. Is that something that I kind of want to get on that?
Okay, what do you want to do? I was just kind of more of a facilitator on that with our cable guy.
Yeah.
So I'll have him call you.
Okay. That'd be fine.
I think him and the past chief worked it out.
Okay.
And I just kind of brought the popcorn, which I can do again this time, and the things that I have a popcorn machine at work. And,
okay.
But, and I'll...
just have him give me a call, and I think we've tentatively set up a couple dates
he's,
for movie night in August.
I'm doing it right now, because he just texted me saying that we're live and we're recording. Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thanks for coming in. Okay, first item on the agenda is I want to continue the public hearing on the intersection of Georgetown Road and Crane Neck Street. Just to fill in background for people that may be listening, there as a result of a couple of accidents at that location, we had requested, or DPW requested, the Merrimack Valley Planning Commission do a traffic study of that intersection, and we now have the results of that analysis. And I just want to compliment the DPW for adding speed and intersection signage on Georgetown Road, for adding stop ahead signs on Crane Neck, and moving the stop line and stop sign on Crane Neck Street, and also clearing off that corner. So, I mean, it added to the visibility significantly looking down left.
Ran out of
time. Oh, for cutting?
The chief just came back. Was there another accident there a couple of weeks ago at Georgetown and Crane Neck? Just another recent one?
Nothing I'm aware of.
It seems like reading the. Reading the reports. The fire reports that there was a MVA, Georgetown and
Crane Neck?
Yeah.
I'm not sure.
Just so you know, all the stuff that we've done on the southbound side, I believe all the accidents were vehicles coming out of the other side, which there isn't a sight distance problem or anything.
Okay.
So just so you guys all know that.
I
does make it a lot better.
It looks good, thank you.
Yep. So since this is a public hearing, I want to open discussion for public input. If anyone from the public has anything to add, hearing none.
Well, I think we should just mention what the report stated. That they did not,
their findings.
Their findings were that the busyness of the, of all, any of the four in any of the four directions that did not warrant a in their opinion did not warrant a four-way sign, and their biggest recommendation was simply to clear vegetation and make,
basically,
which is what we're trying to do.
Basically to do what Gary did.
Exactly.
Okay.
I make a motion that we close the public hearing.
Second. So, okay, want to vote on that? All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
So in terms of, what you said that you're not finished, so what else are you doing?
Vegetation.
Oh, vegetation.
On private property.
That same,
yep.
That same side, or the one further, so you can see even further up. We can get it all done. So. And
what,
then we're going to do a little more on the other corners, do a few things.
What about the stop sign coming down Crane Neck Street? I know you put a stop ahead sign there.
Yeah. You mean from Dr. Brackville? From, is that the one you're talking
from
about?
Down the hill,
from,
you mean?
From middle, going down Crane Neck Street.
Okay.
Well, I kind of questioned
when I looked at it myself, and so I did my own little test. I come down Crane Neck Street 40, got to the second sign, and put on the brakes. I could stop within half the time to get to the sign. So if you miss both signs, I don't know what more we can do. We got the, we actually even got an over regulation size signs up there. All the
right.
Signs are actually oversized. So,
right.
If we move the sign any closer to the road, it'll be out in the road. So there's really not much more you can do about, for that. So.
The one that's on the telephone pole?
Correct.
Okay. All right.
At some point, there
has to be personal responsibility
right. Out right. There
also, where people need to be able to drive in a safe manner and stuff like that. We can't, babysit everything.
Well, yes, but, I mean, he made a lot, the DPW department made a lot of...
No. Yeah. I'm talking about now. I agree.
Yeah. Going forward.
We needed to make those.
Yeah,
yes.
Going forward. Yeah.
I was just, one of the other recommendations, I haven't looked at it in the last month or so, the white line, the actual stop line on the
other side
of Crane Neck was one of their recommendations to move that slightly forward.
It's been done.
Has that been done?
Yeah.
Okay.
You moved that and the stop sign.
And the sign, okay.
Right. Yeah, I mean, I think everything...
Because now you can see going left.
Okay.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, I believe the sign was put where it was. It was an old round post that was before my time was even here, but I think it was to keep the traffic back. When Town Road used to go all the way through, there used to be a lot more truck traffic.
Okay.
So if somebody was right out at the point, like a truck couldn't make that corner without being a problem.
Oh, I see, making a left, okay.
But now, 99.9% of the time, it wouldn't be an issue, so. That was what the study also said. If you can't move that sign forward, then the four-way stop would be
a next.
Right.
Would be the right thing to do.
So, are we in agreement that the improvements were made, they're okay, no actions needed?
No further action.
No further action.
Other than his
yeah, what he just said.
Yeah.
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 Yeah. Okay.
Hold on.
Go ahead.
And maybe a regular maintenance thing to make sure that we don't have the same problem.
Make sure the vegetation doesn't.
Something new?
So
probably going to cost us 10 grand now.
Glenn, you were saying?
You said make sure that we keep...
Regular maintenance plan,
yeah,
you were saying.
Yeah, we make sure we keep an eye on this every year so the vegetation then doesn't grow up.
Okay. Let me just throw out a question. Yes. That's that particular intersection. I mean, are there any other areas that need to be looked at?
We'll be looking at all intersections in Nelson Grad. So checking signage and redoing lines. We'll be doing all of it.
Maybe in the fall when his work time, you know, you do all this in this.
No, we'll be taking Adam for all the years.
Yeah, so just at the end of the year, maybe come back to us after his bad weather sets in and say, hey, Kate, this is what we've done, and this is what we need to do, if that's what you're looking for?
Well, no, I'm just kind of thinking out loud that, and I mean, Gary, I mean, it's not the DPW department's expertise. We had a professional come in from Merrimack Valley. Should we have like a traffic engineer kind of look at our signage and make, give us some recommendations if they think that's appropriate or not, and or say everything is good?
Well, the other thing we could do is see if they're at the end of the year, is there a way to track where there have been motor vehicle accidents, location-wise?
Well, yeah.
Yeah, I don't know if that's, I mean, I'd want
in
to.
Theory,
that's asked after the fact.
Prevent,
I realize that.
Right,
yeah.
Prevent things from happening,
yeah.
Versus,
I mean, will,
chasing
is there something that that Joe just meant? I mean, of course there is. But does Merrimack Valley have a portion of their thing saying, hey, can you assess our whole town on our signage and our lines? Report.
Well, we,
they looked at the one at, remember we looked at the one at Spring Hill and Ash Street, and they recommended putting a,
right.
That, you know, I think if we just go along as we're going and work on things to what we got, and if there's a problem or something, we'll address it. Do all of them, I think it's a little over, you know. I don't think they, you know, it's very selective if you have an accident. I mean, you're going to have one no matter what you do anyway, occasionally. I don't see where.
I would think they would charge us if they were going to look at the entire town.
Well, and I don't know that it has to be Merrimack Valley, and yes, there would be a cost associated with it.
I just asked if they did it, so I didn't mean to get stuck on that one particular.
Right. I mean, you could have a professional traffic engineer come and review. I mean, it would take some time, and there'd be a cost. Are there places that we need signage? Are there places where additional signs? Or are there places where signs need to be like adjusted, or is there a place where a sign needs to be removed? I don't know. It's way beyond my expertise.
We've actually been a lot of the four-way intersections, well, not four-way intersections, but just stops on ones. Mm-hmm. We've already been working on putting stop ahead signs on a lot of them, which really aren't required unless you can't see the sign, but it's good to give somebody the extra one. And so we've been kind of proactive on starting to work on some of that stuff. Mm-hmm. You know, I think we could, you know, if we just went on that way for a while, see how it works out, and if we got any issues, then we'll deal with them.
I mean, I would not be adverse to having a traffic engineer look at, like, are signs in compliance with that, and they referenced in this report, the uniform traffic control devices. Are we in compliance with that, with them or not? I mean, I don't know.
Do you want to have Gary contact Merrimack Valley Planning Commission to see if they do something like that, and if they would do it for us, how much it would cost, and then...
Or if they don't,
we'll recommend somebody who does.
Right, or if they don't, who would?
And just see what it's all about before we make a decision?
Yeah, let's ask them and just see what, you know, what service they would give us and what it would cost.
Would you do that?
Are you okay with that? Or?
Okay. We'll just do it.
Okay.
Have Chris
ready.
Come on.
Okay. Next item on. Next item on the agenda is the school building committee. Let me defer to you gentlemen were at the meeting, so I was on vacation. So we have
a report back from it, or you want to just talk about the...
Well, yeah, I mean, we got a letter requesting to fill four positions from the town. A member of the board, this is for the high school building committee.
Mm-hmm.
Which actually, why don't you go through like what that committee is going to be comprised of from the meeting?
Okay.
Okay, I'll do it.
Do it.
There was a lot of discussion, so just capitalize it as quickly as possible. There was a lot of discussion, do we want a small committee where people come to a consensus and then a group of people have one vote and say four or five people together have one vote and they come together with four or five other groups of four or five people. And after a considerable amount of discussion on different patterns of how this might work, we finally came to the school committee came to the agreement that maybe that wasn't going to be so workable and that it would be hard to perhaps come to a consensus. And so the school committee decided to have a somewhat bigger committee than they had initially planned. Basically, there would be three selectmen, so one selectman from each town. And there was a discussion of whether, as the way the school committee is, whether West Newbury's vote would be the same as the vote from would be equal in its weight as to the other towns, and they determined that it would, and rather than power of the vote, which occurs in the regular school committee. This committee was not going to do that. So, one selectman from each town, a finance director or a member of the FinCom from each town, a community member with some experience in construction or architecture, engineering, school building, something like that. So one member with that kind of experience from each town, one citizen from each town. First, people were thinking that maybe it should be a parent, and then with further discussion, they determined that rather than holding it to a parent, who might even, by the time the school gets built, their child or children might have actually graduated, and certainly everyone has a stake in the school, whether a parent or not. So the school committee decided to have a citizen from each town, an interested citizen, one school committee member from each town, a teacher from the high school, and four administrators from the school, regional school district. So there's the principal, the business administrator, the director of facilities, and the superintendent. And the administrative team of the district, rather than, even though those four people and they would all be on the committee, it was determined that they would actually only have one vote. So this actually gave the member towns a significant increase in the first of all, in their participation, in the numbers of people, but their say in the situation was increased because there were lesser voting power, you might say, of the people from the district. So altogether, 20 people and 17 voting members. Mm-hmm. So each town has to come up with, I believe, yes, ultimately five people.
Mm-hmm. So we have to submit this by July 27th. Our next meeting is July 25th. So we have until if there are people interested in one of the two community positions, they should contact Chris Pyle in the Selectman's office.
Correct. And I have two people already that I'd like to, they've already contacted me.
Yep.
That I'd like to give tonight. Yep.
Let me add that the reason, why is there a hurry about this? Why? Because this is kind of an important position, and it's something that people might be on this committee for 3, 4, 5 years. It's people should know, anyone that's volunteering, that this is not going to be a couple of meetings in November and they're gone. It's intended that these people will be on the committee for a considerable amount of time, and so it's a big commitment. But the reason that we're so with a big commitment, and we want to make sure we have the right people on there, why is we sort of rushing it? We're not rushing it. The district is under an obligation to report back to the
MSBA,
I believe by August 2nd, with our nominated members. So, and they have to, the school committee has to hear our nominations, and then
they have to vote them.
They have to vote our the people that we have nominated. Yes.
Okay.
I would second everything that Archie said. And a couple of things was I was at the meeting. I just wanted to thank the school committee because I think they listened to the individuals that were at that public hearing, mm-hmm. Other selectmen from other towns, and of course, the representatives that were from West Newbury, including there were individuals and the selectmen. Because I think it started off, I think the superintendent's recommendation was a little bit smaller and not inclusive of the towns, but I think the school committee heard everybody there, and I think they understood that it would be important to make sure that the towns would get their voices heard.
Yep.
And Archie's correct in saying that we have those to fill, and the school committee members, those representatives will be picked from each town. So the three school committee members from West Newbury will pick a representative of them, and so forth and so on.
Good. In terms of, I know the community people will have to get all the people that want to submit for that. But in terms of, let's have a just general discussion on the first two items on the selectmen. I just want to say from a time capacity standpoint, I don't have the time. I have the time to fully fulfill my selectmen obligations, but
yeah, being chairperson, you,
but I don't have the extra capacity beyond that to do something mm-hmm. that's involved as this would be. So I just want to put that out there. So kind of up to you two gentlemen.
Well, it'd be up to Archie and I. If he wants to do it, if I want to do it, we can always do rock, paper, scissors. I mean, if you really want to do it, because I kind of want to do it, and if you want to do it, but I mean, if you really, really, really want to do it, you know, if I lost in rock, paper, scissors, I wouldn't mind. And maybe, I know this is going to be a new revelation, but sometimes I'm a polarizing individual. So it might be a good idea.
I've yet to experience that.
So it might be a good idea that I might not be on. I don't know. But who knows?
Yeah.
I would have all good intentions and stuff. So I think it's going to be a great dynamic committee, especially the way that it's made up. I think it's going to represent all three towns in the best way it possibly can, and I know the best results will come from this. We can talk about it. And
yeah.
Then the other one we'd have to talk about if we want a FinCom person or do we want our finance director.
Right.
Something that was discussed that we can't say like a designee, you know what I mean? Because it has to be that individual, because when the MSBA, they have to approve this committee, and when they approve it, you have to, your name, your email address, your phone number. They want all these things.
So it's the person, not the title.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It's the person. So, and to be able to, and it could be changed, but then you would need, they need 20 days in advance to be able to change any, for their approval, for anybody to be on the committee. So,
yeah.
We can talk to.
Yeah, I mean, Mike, we're not deciding anything, but do you have any comments on that, or in terms of like yourself or a FinCom member? I think the microphone's over there.
I would like to see if there was, who had the most interest in it, because sometimes, because it is such a long commitment, if somebody has a desire to see this through to the end, we might get more, juice out of them.
So does that mean you're not going to be here for very much longer?
Well, you said 3 or 4 years.
You don't even know what you're having for dinner tomorrow night.
Exactly. Okay. I don't even know if dinner's going to be on the table when I get home tonight.
Okay, I got you.
But sometimes if you have a little more attachment to the community, it helps a little. I've been on committees like this before, and It is a big commitment. You don't want to downplay that.
It's huge.
Has a lot of authority, and there's a big time commitment to it. And I'm on the FinCom as well as a ex officio, but they're meeting upstairs now.
Okay.
Yes.
Do you need to go up there?
We should.
Do you want to go up? Why don't you go?
No, because there's more stuff here.
They're kind of doing
stuff.
More, yeah. You're gonna say something.
Gotcha.
I was gonna say they have to be informed that they ought to be thinking about that. Yeah.
So why don't one of us, after we finish this meeting, because I know
yeah.
I know that we only should be here for another 5 minutes.
Yeah. Well, actually,
we can go up and tell them. Well, Mike can do it.
Mike, how about if Mike? Can you do that?
Just real quick, when you get to.
You want to do the transfers first, just in sure. case there's any questions, and then.
Can you do me a favor, though?
When you're going to make those.
25th. Can you? This.
We have to.
Yeah. This is the packet the superintendent gave us,
okay.
So they have an understanding of it.
Okay.
You can give it to them, and then I'll get another one from Chris, whenever I need one.
Okay, done with that topic?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Next item on the agenda is line item transfers. I move to approve the transfer of $1,000 from dispatch salaries and wages to be transferred to dispatch expense.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
I move to approve the transfer of $2,000 from police salary and wages to police expenses.
No, $1,000.
It's two.
Oh, it's two?
Yes.
It got changed.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, this transfer from the reserve fund, we don't vote that.
That's right. No vote.
Okay, fine. Mm-hmm. Okay, good. All right. We're set. Thank you. Next item on the agenda is MVPC Municipal Energy Technical Assistance Grant. Mr. Karen.
I just want to let you know that we're cooperating with the Merrimack Valley Planning Commission to apply to the Department of Energy Resources to get a grant in order to help fund someone to assist the town in fulfilling all its reports under the Green Communities. Last year we're a little late with getting it done because it's all done by volunteers and they do it when they can.
Rick.
And there's included in your packet. But essentially, we are the prototype because we've been very active. We've done a lot to promote energy efficiency in the town, but they want to keep up the paperwork and stuff. So what this will do is this will give us basically a staff person who will do the paperwork to get all our reports in time, and then we'll be eligible for more grants.
So make a motion that we give permission to whomever, Mike or whomever it is, to apply for the Municipal Energy Technical Assistance Grant.
Second. Discussion.
Would this person be a town employee or
no,
a contract
they,
employee? Or
no,
what?
They work for the Merrimack Valley Planning Commission.
Oh, okay.
So they just come in like a consultant.
Okay.
Do our paperwork, and then that's it.
Perfect.
Submit the work. So.
Okay. Good.
What's not to like?
Exactly. Okay.
Doesn't cost us anything.
Right.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Are you here for a selectmen's meeting?
No.
Okay. Just want to make sure. Because there's so many meetings. I see people coming to the door, and I keep on looking at the agenda, and sometimes people have sat there. It's like half an hour, then, oh my word, my meeting's upstairs. I just want to make
is
sure.
Is the topic you are here
there,
for on the agenda?
I don't know.
What topic is that?
What was that?
The Airbnbs. We didn't know if we were going to discuss it tonight.
That's the
nope.
conservation. The Airbnb or the boat?
Airbnb, that's the boat. My husband's up there.
No, nope, it's
I
not.
I didn't know if you came to any conclusions based on the meeting.
No.
Nope. Well, no, we did. We gave him a temporary license.
Yeah, well, that.
But we haven't.
Yeah, that was voted at the
yeah,
meeting. Yeah.
The meeting
yeah.
Right.
Yeah. There was nothing
else beyond that.
No.
Well, just to update, I mean, this is just what we had previously said. We are looking at permanent lodging house regulations, and at our next meeting, actually, on the 25th, in all probability, we'll be reviewing a draft of that.
Okay, that's, we didn't know if the draft was going to be presented tonight.
No, no.
And a lot more host of questions came up out of that meeting because of other individuals that are doing it in town. And, you know, the thresholds that fall underneath the regulations, and it's a whole new...
It's way more complicated than we imagined.
Yep, and a ton of it is going on in town that would not even fall. We're going to...
We'll come back on the 25th.
Thank you.
And the issue of the mooring that's been dropped there recently in the Merrimack River, is that just going to be discussed at Concom?
We're not sure about that. All we know about that is it's a legal mooring.
It's a legal or illegal?
Legal. Legal mooring.
They have a mooring permit.
He got a mooring permit. I don't know if it's a legal mooring.
Okay. That's a lawyer speaking. There is a legal mooring permit for that structure. And I guess it falls under Concom's regulations because at low tide, it sits on the mud.
And it would also fall under, like, the Coast Guard and the environmental police because it's in a navigable river.
Okay.
Yeah, but that...
So it's not something that you guys
would
take up?
No, it does, but the mooring is...
Right, that's us.
I have nothing else to say about it because if I did, I'd only be making it up. All I know is that we were presented with some photos. We made sure the proper people in town were notified. And the first step was, if there was a mooring permit for it, and there was, and we don't have any regulations opposed from houseboat or regular boat, all you need to have, they're all considered boats. If it was a sailboat, a motorboat, a pontoon boat, they're all considered boats, and then it's going down the chain of command.
Not unless something new comes up. Okay, next item on the agenda is Harbor Master pump out boat. I'm gonna pass that by and come back to it when Mr. Pertino returns. Next item on the agenda after that is Maple and Main Street intersection. I believe you requested this.
Yeah, I just wanted to put it on the agenda so we can put it on the agenda.
Maple and Main, okay.
What's going on is we're getting a lot of citizens have come in, and I wish the chief was here.
He was.
He just left.
I know, but to talk about this, and I just realized it, because we have details. We have details in town for things that you go, why is there a detail? There's been more going on in that intersection than I can imagine, with the septic system being put on one side of the road, the bank put it on the other. You couldn't even get through there. There probably should have been detail there for all last week. But all I know is I don't know.
Well, if they were blocking the road.
Yeah, it should have been.
There should have been.
Yeah. But all I know, but that's just the past. But all I know is that there's a lot of questions going to happen, and that intersection is not going to be the same. Mm-hmm. That bank's going to be there. Mm-hmm. So we need to maybe... There's a lot of concern in the neighborhood about it. We should maybe talk about it, that's it.
Yes.
And I don't really want to talk about it tonight because the neighborhood would have come in.
Yeah.
But
so
they asked me and I told them that it was just going to be on so we could...
Discussion
to
what to
set
do.
Up a meeting.
How to proceed.
Yeah.
So I guess two questions come to mind, or one question. The bank is under construction right now, which is a finite period of time. I mean, they're going pretty fast, so maybe a couple of months.
Mm-hmm.
So in a couple of months, they'll be done. So
we can see what real life
looks like. What's it look like then when they're open and, like, people are, customers are coming and going, where the bank personnel are going to park? I mean, banks to me, I don't go to a bank.
Well, you keep it all under your mattress?
I think I went deposit
and all that stuff.
Yeah. So, you know, people come for 10 minutes and they leave. So it's like two or three people. So
Sometimes the unknown scares people. And if they kind of know that, we might take care of it if there's a problem.
Oh, absolutely. If there is, yeah.
Everybody might be happy.
I went to a meeting a couple of months ago with the somebody from the bank, actually, and I was concerned about Main Street, what's going to happen there, and just for information purposes, and the there is going to be a front door, like a front door to the house, mm-hmm. but they don't anticipate that being used very much as an actual entrance. And I was concerned about, I don't want seven cars parking on Main Street right in the front there, causing more, you know,
mm-hmm. right.
clutter on Main Street. And they thought that, and I said, we might have even though it's a state highway, we may get permission to put signs related to that. But like they didn't anticipate any car traffic or very little pedestrian traffic, at least on the Main Street side. So that's all I can add.
Right. There's also people that park at the barber shop on the street, though, which that's kind of okay.
But that's a little bit back from the corner. Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. And then
they have the same. We have signs across the street at the post office that say no parking here to the corner.
Right.
So it could be the same.
Right.
But yeah. All I wanted to do was just kind of
raise the awareness.
Raise the awareness, and then when it's all done, maybe have the police chief maybe come in, talk to Gary, maybe talk to have the police chief go down there and talk to the neighbors, maybe at one a little community outreach, just what their concerns are, if any. It might all be all nothing at the end.
Yeah, let's see what it looks like, and if it's something, we'll deal with it certainly. Okay.
Hey, is it all right if I ask the police chief to just keep an eye on that corner?
Yeah.
That whole intersection
sure.
now with all this construction, if he feels that it's too much is
if
going on.
If there's a
there.
Detail that's needed, like there was last week and wasn't one there.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
So, okay. So looping back to the Harbor Master pump out boat, Mike, do you have the microphone somewhere?
Yes, we got a recent inquiry from the state to find out the status of our program, and basically
the state who?
Department of Wildlife and Fisheries. Mm-hmm. They just basically sent out a survey, and they want to know, the condition of our equipment, the serial numbers, do we see any major repairs in the next, 6 to 12 months and beyond, what are the hours of operation, etc. I think they're trying to get a handle on what the condition of the equipment they have out there and what level of service they're getting.
Okay. So,
you need any help?
Yeah, so I'm going to respond. I went up, I looked at the equipment.
All relatively new. I mean, the motor
yeah,
and everything.
It's in relatively good shape. It just needs a good cleaning, and that we're in transition, and then we hope to continue a program in the early, starting the early spring because of the recent retirement.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, next item on the agenda is Selectmen's objectives, results. I just filled in and read just my opinion. That's all that is.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know if you have any other comments, but I would just say that kind of mixed results, some items accomplished, some not accomplished, some things are in progress. So I don't know if anybody has any comments on any of these areas.
I think one that we bring it up and then it other things take precedence over it, but I still think our goal of like having a real plan for what to do with basically each parcel of our town-owned land is important. We think, well, maybe we'll do this with something, and then we forget about it, and then I think that it should be a strategy on, like, this particular parcel could be good for A, B, and C. We have that, but then it sort of didn't get fully
discussed,
fully discussed and finalized. People have put a lot of time into that, actually, but it hasn't been, you know, the Open Space Committee and other groups have actually done the work, but I think we really need to just have that as a resource.
So, like, as an example, the Mullen property we own, is it just open space? Should we be doing something with it? Should we sell it? Should we whatever it? Is that what you mean?
Right.
Okay.
And there was a committee that Mr. Sarkis worked on.
Did
quite a lot of work on that, but we didn't really finalize it.
Mm-hmm. Do you have anything, Glenn? Mm-hmm. Okay, so, I mean, that's last year. As we move into next year.
This one, we should try to get things completed, no? Or move on this thing before?
We should
revisit them.
Well, like, let's just use, to not go through the whole list, but like the very first item says not...
Revised capital plan.
Capital plan, it's not accomplished, carry forward. I think we all agreed we want to do a better job in our capital improvements area. So that would be something to put on for fiscal 17 priorities.
I think even, maybe to Archie's point, that we, before we even think of anything new, unless something jumps out, really, really work hard on these. Put some deadlines on them for this year.
Yep. Yeah, I would say that, yes, but then also, you know, finance director and FinCom to revise financial policies. I don't know that was like, it was looked at. I don't know if it was like completed, but I don't know I would put that on the list.
Yeah, we have drafts. Final drafts are out. It's just there's some new information that we recently discussed, and we have to decide what direction we're going to go in. We have to add some of the new funds
that
we added this year.
Right. So moving forward, next time, can we have a discussion for ourselves as far as what we, you know, if we want to carry forward things, do we have new priorities? I mean, I could name four things real quick on priorities for next year. One is establish a new water source. I think we've talked about that a little bit. Continue with the high school building project, both from a funding standpoint. The chief's back if you had a question for him. Hey, Art. Let me just finish my thought here, then there was a question for you. So, water source, high school building, I think that we should begin to, and this is just my opinion, but begin to explore, you know, do we want a town manager or town administrator to manage day-to-day activity of the town? And then lastly, obviously we had some issues in the development off of Whetstone Street, and if there's going to be another development of a similar size, I think we need to get on top of additional developer oversight. But those are just four ideas that I had.
Yes, with the town's interest.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, we had some learnings from that, so let's apply them.
I would agree.
Lastly, with the objectives, then we'll go back to Art. So the department head objectives results were all due today. I don't know that they're all here. I presume they'll be floating in the next couple of days. Maybe you could send a reminder to whoever has not done that. So should we have the same review, department head review process that we had last year, continue that process?
I would.
Right.
What do you think? You think it's useful?
I'm not sure. What give me your...
I would. I mean, I think it's a process like you do it once, you do it again, you improve, you do it again, and you brought it up a couple of levels. I would even suggest that we do the same people that we did last year. That way there's some continuity of discussion.
Okay.
But that's just me.
Let's think about that.
Okay, yeah, we can talk about it next time. No rush. Okay.
Because it, you know, they set the objectives, they meet the objectives. And then it's almost like we're...
Well, I wouldn't arbitrarily say they meet the objectives. I think some do, mm-hmm. some don't.
Yeah, when I did my review, it was, I don't know, it's almost like then we're stamping that everything in that department is good, and you know what I mean by that?
Mm-hmm.
And we're not micromanaging it in the sense...
Well, I don't think it's micromanaging.
No, I'm saying that it's not.
Yeah.
I'm agreeing with you. I'm saying that it's not. I have to think about it. I'm not articulating it as well as I...
Okay, yeah, we can talk about it next time.
But it's like, I don't know. Let me think about it.
Yeah, no problem.
I don't know how good it is.
Chief Reed, there was a question on the intersection of Maple and Main Street, and I think Mr. Kemper actually had a question.
Just with all the construction going on there and with a lot of stuff going on in the house that across the street with the new septic system, if you could just have you or your officers keep an eye on it, how safe that is on there, that maybe the bank needs a detail there when there's some days there's a lot of stuff going on there and people can't, you know, it's down to one lane and people can't get through.
If they're blocking the street.
You know, so maybe if you just keep an eye on it on a regular patrol and say, hey, listen, you know, you got a lot of stuff going on there. You're going to need you might need one or you have that. We're just getting some feedback from the neighbors, and I've actually was called and I went down there. They asked me to, and I witnessed it.
Is there a point person?
Yeah, the guy's name is Larry Bird. And I'm not kidding. And Michael McCarron has his number. And he's very responsive, and he's excellent, because there was some noise complaints that came through that I had taken care of early on, and he was very quick to respond to it, and we haven't had a complaint ever since. But yeah, his name is Larry Bird. He's not as tall, actually.
Okay. Thank you. Next item on the agenda is telephone systems. Mr. Archibald?
I thought the telephone system, weren't we told that it was not very good? And then
yes.
We were told it's a great system.
Yes.
It can
but yes, but at the last meeting, Archie requested to discuss it.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Sorry.
I did a little research. There's several ways. I still think it's worth doing. We have every department has different vendors. We have different contracts. Maybe it's a waste of time, but I really don't think so. I think we could realize some savings and some efficiencies if we had the same interchangeable equipment, for example, or this ultimately the same vendor for services as
mobile too.
What's
mobile too?
All phone, internet kind of services together. And I mean, there are two ways we could look at it. There are vendors that strictly do consulting to give you an idea of whether you could, they'll analyze all your bills and give you an idea of whether you could realize some savings by doing something. And then there are other vendors that strictly will provide, they will be a service provider and integrate all the different services in one and hopefully gets savings that way. The only trouble with that is I think we should get just someone give us an opinion on it and maybe pay a few dollars to have a consultant give us opinion on it rather than talking to actual vendors of internet or phone services, because they're obviously going to say, yeah, you need to do it,
yeah.
Versus a consultant. But there are ones that actually specialize in dealing with small businesses, small towns. We would sort of be in that in at that level, and I think it would work. The only trouble is obviously different departments that have say different a mobile service contract, and this would take some time to until different contracts ran out, we can't be getting new phones or new contracts or whatever. But I still think it would be worth looking into, and doing it, especially doing it with a consultant first.
Any comments from either of the mics?
As far as our main system, you know, I'm comfortable with it, talking to the different people, that it still has, you know, 8 to 15 years of useful life. I did have that one issue where you called me after last meeting, it didn't work. I called him, he told me what to do. It was a software issue. Sometimes when the server resets, it resets the default settings. Mm-hmm. So I went in and changed it. Now I've been getting phone calls again. And that was no charge. He just told me what to do.
Yeah, and I haven't had a problem since then.
Yeah. So I'm thinking that, yeah, are there some dormant numbers out there? It could be. And we, you know, that's something we could put on our list to do, is call the numbers to see where they ring and where they don't. But as far as investing in new hardware and I don't think it's worth it yet, because we still have a good amount of useful life left.
I think actually we need to, now that you mention that, we need to go through all these numbers. 119, you still have the dog officer there, so somebody could be calling and leaving a message on that. I don't know if is he checking those? I don't even know. Or is that one still there?
I think it refers him to calls.
Okay. I think it's different. Yeah, exactly. That's what my next thing was. So I would actually go through there.
Get some senior help to help us with that, just to call all the numbers.
The 119, and just get the people that aren't there anymore. They could be leaving messages, and we don't even know.
Generally,
what about the different mobile services? Is there anything to be gained? We have the same vendor for that, rather than each department having a separate contract.
So maybe it's better to say, how do we do it now, and why do we do it that way? And if we had one provider for everybody, would it be more efficient? I think some people are on town plans, some people get stipends, some people, I don't know. I think it's so convoluted
all
that
over the map.
Yeah,
right.
That we don't
it's
even know.
It's all over them, yeah.
Mm. Well, most people, so they don't have to carry multiple phones, get stipends.
So they use their own personal phone,
and they get a stipend.
And we give them X amount of money.
And that is a pretty inexpensive way to do it, because it's almost half of what the standard was a while ago.
Phone breaks.
So we're paying less than half their responsibility to phone. Have a working, in, you know, capable working phone.
Phone breaks on town time, we don't pay to get it fixed.
They're responsible because it's their phone. There's a whole letter written up I read before, and the reimbursement they get goes through payroll, and gets, you know, they get it that way. And most of the reason, my understanding was, and basically the IRS allows you to do this because they know how tedious it is to collect all the information and to reimburse them for the calls. So they allow you a certain amount of money to pay without collecting the information. And it was researched before I got here. And that was the letter that they get, $45 for that. And
a month?
Yes, a month. So they only carry one phone rather than, you know, two. I think with the exception of public safety, I think that's how all of them are.
Public safety has town-owned phones?
I think public safety is a little different. I'm not, you know, because I think, you know, so the chief from last year and the chief this year have the same number.
Mm-hmm.
So I think they pass it on, and that's more of an active duty type response. So, and there's, you know, where if you're chasing somebody or driving, you're more likely to go through a phone, so that would be covered under public safety, whereas everybody else uses it to get a hold of their supervisor
or vice versa.
I think if you think it would be a savings to go with one, if you could look at it and report back to us.
I mean, we could, you know, we could try, but it's a pretty good deal you're getting now at 45.
Right, and how much are you going to save?
Yeah. You're probably going to cost you more money, because when people realize what their phone bill actually is after they take time to look at it, you might have to bump it up to 75. That's what I used to pay, 75.
Oh, in Winthrop?
Really?
It's a lot of, you know, those things aren't cheap. You break the, you know, you're riding on a lawnmower, falls out of the truck, it's on you. You know, phone doesn't last but a year and a half, 2 years at the most, before you sit on it, break it, crack it. So it's pretty efficient there. I think there's, you know, we talked a little bit about some of the other things that we are doing to save money. You know, there's many other things that...
So we're going to save $20 and right. Cost us $1,000 at the end.
Perhaps, yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay, all right. Next item on the agenda is appointments. I know we've been looking for a couple of members of the to add to the Capital Improvements Committee. I think I found one person was suggested. He's a name is Brad. I don't know how to pronounce the last name. So it's Beaudoin. He's actually a DDS. And he lives on Coffin Street. So I talked to him, he seemed articulate, and he was recommended by one of the Finance Committee members who knows him personally. So move to appoint Brad.
Second.
Whoever's, I can't say it. Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Back to the regular appointment list. I think there's only one or two people on here that are okay. So move to appoint Vanessa Goldstein to the Community Center Committee for a term of 1 year.
Second.
Discussion, all in favor?
Aye. Aye. I make a motion that we put Richard Atwater to the Car Post Building.
We had done that, but we can do it again.
Oh, I just have it out here. Huh? Okay, thank you. I can't make...
Move to approve to appoint Rose Vitier to the Cultural Council for a term ending June 15th, 2019.
Second.
Discussion, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay.
And we received an email from Leah Zambardini of the Planning Board from her past experience. She has a knowledge and capacity for the affordable housing that you had CPC community had talked about a couple of meetings ago. In fact, she served as a board member of the Beverly Affordable Housing Coalition, which is now the North Shore Community Housing Coalition, and she's written and administered affordable housing ordinances for them. So I think she probably would be a good member of this committee, and I don't see a lot of people lining up at the door for it.
Okay. I did a little bit of research on that afterwards, and I think our housing, can we put this on agenda for a future thing rather than appointing her now?
Yeah.
And have a makeup of this committee, or work with the affordable housing committee that we already have in place?
CCC?
Housing Authority.
Housing Authority. Are they two different things, though?
Different things.
They're different things, but if you read their bylaw, I want to have a discussion about this.
Okay, we should look at it. That's fine.
Okay. I just can't remember what it is. This was before I went on.
No problem.
It's like a month ago. I have to get my notes back up.
Okay. Does anybody else have any other appointments? Okay. Moving on to the next item on the agenda, payroll invoice warrants. I move to approve the payroll warrant.
Second.
Discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Abstain. Make a motion to approve the invoice warrants.
Second. Discussion. No stickies. There's no stickies. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Placing, oh, there's one other thing I wanted to say. I'm sorry, on appointments, I forgot. We still have a number of committee positions that are that remain open. If there's interest from the community, please contact Chris Pyle. Those are, there's still a position on Capital Improvements Committee. There's an at-large position on the Community Preservation Committee, the Bicentennial Committee, the Historical Commission has an opening, and I believe the Car Post Building Committee also has an opening.
Can you, can we send a, Chairman, can I ask Chris, or ask you guys what you think? Can we send a email out to all the standing committees and ask them if they would like to be on this Bicentennial Committee? Do you want to start getting going this fall?
Sure.
Like the Historical Commission might want to have somebody, and it might
right.
be helpful
to be represented.
To be
right.
represented.
That's
the planning
a great
board
idea.
Might, the open space, and maybe start internally.
Yep.
Park and Rec might want one because it's going to be, you know, we're going to have.
It's a big thing.
Yeah, we're going to have fields and field that, you know, hopefully, and get everybody involved.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And then we can start there and then get some.
Are you okay?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Placing of items on future agendas.
Whatever we do, don't put anything on the 25th. It seems like we have a busy day.
Why? What's on the 25th?
I don't know. You named like two or three things that we're already doing.
Oh. Do you have anything?
No.
They could go on after the 25th.
I'm kidding.
Yes, sir.
Just one thing I'd like to bring up is that this year, for the presidential election in November,
mm-hmm.
We're going to be required to have early voting.
Mm-hmm.
Which is kind of like absentee ballot, but you just do it. You don't have to
right.
worry about it. But one of the things that they're going to require is that the town set up a polling place where people can cast their ballot. You know,
what does
like
this mean? Define early voting first. That might help
okay.
us understand.
Okay, first time you heard of it? Okay.
No. It's not the first time I've heard it, but pertaining to
define
our town, what
is
does it mean?
Basically for the presidential election,
yep.
not for other elections.
Got it.
But basically for the presidential and gubernatorial elections,
mm-hmm.
people will be allowed to vote basically 14 business days prior to the election. Previous to that, if you wanted to vote early, you had to fill out an absentee ballot, but you were limited in the reasons that you could fill out an absentee ballot, meaning that you were not going to be in the community during polling hours or you had it was on a day that you had religious objections to doing it for. Now, it doesn't matter. It's just if you want to vote early, you can vote early.
So we have to set up a room for people to vote.
We just have to set up
14 business days.
Right.
Does it have to be monitored the whole time?
No. What I'm suggesting is that we take a couple of booths that we have, the voting booths. And we use the center hallway between the finance director and the like. We just set it up right there.
Finance director and the assessor's office.
And assessor's office. Mm-hmm. And so they would come into the town clerk's office. They would get their ballot. They could go there, cast their vote, and then come back and just, because we don't count the ballots there. We put them in an envelope and we store them. But we have to have a place where they can do that. Right now, when we did absentees, they just did it right at the front counter.
Okay.
But we're supposed to have a place. And I'm supposed to have to set up the auto mock machine so that in the event that someone who has, you know, visual problems or, you know.
So a regular polling place is open from 7 to 8. Do we have to have it available from 7 to 8 or can
no,
it be regular
be
business
open
hours?
Only during regular business hours of the town from
that's a good question,
8
though.
To 4:30 Monday through Thursday and then, so when the town clerk's office is open, the early voting.
This is new to the state?
This is new. This is the first year they've done it.
Yeah, because other states have been doing this because you can see, you know,
mm-hmm.
when I'm looking at election returns, it's saying,
yeah.
Oh, yeah, we had 400,000 of early voting. I'm just like, how does that even possibly?
Yeah.
This is what they were talking
so.
About.
Yeah. So,
okay,
I just,
so why are you telling us? Just so
just
if somebody asks us.
I just want you to designate, you, was it, you know, the room as, because then we have to send a letter.
Is there lights? Are there lights in that hallway?
Yes.
It's always been dark. I don't know.
Well, we have a light. We know who turns it on.
Yeah, it's the old entrance to the place.
Right.
Okay, that's fine.
With me, fine.
Makes sense, yep.
But we're going to have to send a letter. I don't know if you want to put it on the separate agenda to talk about it.
Send a letter to
whom?
The Secretary of State saying, telling them.
Can you just do that?
Why don't you just
I will do that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Consider it done.
Okay.
All right.
Any other discussion for this evening?
I would ask if we could have an update on the air handles on our 25th meeting.
I thought you weren't going to answer anything.
No, in lasting less than 2 minutes. No, we can't because it wasn't on the agenda. I can ask you. Then you know what? We'll just go individually to them then.
Okay. No.
But let's talk about it.
Well, what I would ask
publicly
is,
next time, yeah.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. And what I would ask, if there's any problem.
Any what?
Problem.
Oh.
That arises that Gary contacts you immediately. No matter when, if it's on a Sunday at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So we can get on it as immediate as, you know, as possible.
Okay. I move to accept the correspondence.
Second.
Discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay.
Are you guys following up with the historical commission?
On.
We are waiting. We're waiting for the finance committee to answer. I'm basically available whenever they're available, but that's been the holdup. Yeah, I believe it's on their agenda for this evening. I move to go into executive session for the discussion of potential litigation, MGL Section 21A. 3, to discuss strategy with respect to collective bargaining or litigation if an open meeting may have a detrimental effect on the bargaining or litigation of the public body and the chair so designates. Also, MGL Chapter 30A, Section 21A, 2, to conduct strategy sessions in preparation for negotiations with non-union personnel or conduct collective bargaining sessions or contract negotiations with non-union personnel, and also an Elliott Fund discussion.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And who's going into
the discussion? That's a good question. The Board of Selectmen, Michael McCarron, Mike Bertino, Chris Pyle, and attorney.
State, I don't care.
We can't do it.
We're leaving. We're going to a different room. And attorney William,
Farachi.
Yes.
Farachi.
Yes.